As a technician, you'll be frequently working on electronic equipment. You'll likely be performing calibration, testing, and fault finding on these electronic loops and circuits. In order to understand exactly what is happening within these loops and perform your role as a technician, it's vital you understand how to use a digital process or multimeter in order to measure and simulate loop characteristics such as voltage, current, and resistance within these circuits. In this video, I'm going to teach you exactly how to do that using a Fluke 117 multimeter, which is an extremely common multimeter used within industry. Although other meter manufacturers use similar symbols and functions, so this guide should assist you with most meter types. It is important to remember that electricity can be extremely dangerous, and in the worst cases, cause death. For that reason, only work on systems that you have the competency to do so, and ensure to follow local legislation and guidance, and always isolate loops electrically where applicable. This is a Fluke 117 multimeter. It is a quality multimeter that has all the basic functionality for taking measurements from an electronic loop. It does not have the functionality to simulate currents that you will need for calibration of input devices and some fault finding. For that type of work, you'll need a process meter like the Fluke 789. I'll go over its functionality in the next video. Let's go over the components of a meter. Here is the screen or readout. It shows you the value of what you are measuring. This could be voltage, current, resistance, frequency, or capacitance. The readout will give you units, a scale, and other visual information about your measurements. Below the readout, we have several buttons that give different functionality. Some buttons have varying functionality dependent on your mode selection, but we will go over the main functions here. The hold button can be used during measurement readings to freeze the display. This is useful if you have a varying reading that you need to record at a certain time, or if lone working will allow you to free both hands and record the reading on paperwork such as calibration documentation. The min-max button allows you to enter a mode that will record the highest, lowest, and average reading recorded since entering the mode. The range button will allow you to enter either an auto-ranging or manual-ranging mode. For most applications, auto-ranging will be best, and will select the unit value most appropriate. It's most notable during resistance readings where you could be reading anything from ohms, kilo-ohms, or megohms. The yellow button is used to give alternative function. If you look at the selector dial, you'll notice certain symbols are in yellow. The yellow button allows you to utilize these functions. The lamp button will give you a backlight to the display, perfect for working in cabinets that may not have decent lighting. The selector dial allows you to change between the different operating modes of the meter, depending on the specific task that you are carrying out. Look at the different symbols around the outside of the dial. These indicate the function of the meter. We will go through all of these symbols in detail later in the video. At the bottom, we have the ports where we connect our test leads. Depending on the mode, we will be connecting our leads in different ports. Don't worry though, I'll show you exactly where to connect the probes for each mode when carrying out tests. Here is an example of a set of probes or test leads you will use with a multimeter. These allow you to connect the meter to a circuit electrically at different points to take the readings you need. Probes usually come in two specific types. Probes that allow us to hold the probes on terminals or other electrical conductors, or clips that are used to connect to disconnected wires or earth points. Before using your meter, you should give it a once over and ensure it is in good working order. Check to see if the equipment is within calibration. You will often find a calibration sticker or label on the equipment. This is often under the protective casing. Check the leads for any damage to the insulation. It's important to check the type of leads that you are using. Depending on the country you are working in, there could be guidance or legislation that states your test leads have to be fused and meet certain quality standards. Here in the UK, we have the GS38 guidance notes that lay out what British standards test probes should be manufactured to. Always check your local guidance. Next, let's go through each mode on the rotary selector and talk about what that mode is and what you might be testing with it as a technician. Let's look at the symbol on the mode selector. The V stands for voltage. More specifically, this mode is AC, or alternating current voltage. You can tell by looking at the wavy line above the V. This is how the sine wave of AC current would look on a scope or if voltage were graphed against time. Voltage is the potential difference of energy between two conductors. If these conductors are connected, we will form a circuit and current flows. AC voltages you would be typically measuring in industry, depending on your region, are single phase at 110 to 120, or 230 to 240, and three phase 380 to 415 volts. These voltages are typically found in supply type applications, such as equipment power supplies, contactors, cabinet lighting and heaters. They are rarely used in signal applications. For our probe configuration, our black probe would be connected to common and our red probe connected to the V port. Our probes connect between whatever two conductors we are checking voltage between. In single phase applications, this is usually between live and neutral, and three phase applications, we will be measuring between the phases or phase to neutral or earth. Looking at the hertz symbol in yellow on this mode, if we press the yellow function button while measuring an AC voltage, we will be able to determine its frequency measured in hertz. A hertz is how many times a second the alternating current voltages cycles. Think back to the wave symbol. Typical power supplies in the UK and Europe and most of Asia are 50 hertz, whereas voltages in the US are usually 60 hertz. This mode is for measuring DC or direct current voltage. Notice there is no hertz function available in this mode. This is because this mode is for measuring DC and there is no frequency as the current continually flows in a single direction. Some equipment may be powered by DC voltages, such as PLC equipment or solenoid supplies, especially if these are battery powered or battery backed, but they are also found in signal applications, such as the voltage in a 4 to 20 milliamp transmitter loop for analog signals, and also in digital signals where equipment is looking for voltage to be present or not to determine an input state. Common DC voltages we may be testing for are 5, 12, 24 and 110 volts DC. Our probes are connected to common and the V ports, just as with the AC voltage. And again, our probes are to go between the positive conductor and 0 volts or negative conductor. Millivolts are almost exclusively used for signal measurements. A prime example is a thermocouple that will give us a milli or microvolt reading depending on the temperature the probe is. Using the shift button will give you the function to measure DC millivolts. As in other voltage measuring modes, our probes are connected to common and volts. In the auto volt selection mode, the meter will automatically detect the voltage type and change the units accordingly. Again, probes are in common and voltage. Our last voltage measurement mode is the volt alert mode. In this mode, the meter can detect AC voltage without the use of test leads. Simply place the top of the meter near a live conductor. If a voltage is detected, the meter will illuminate and a beeping sound will be present. Don't use this mode as proof there is no voltage and always carry out full test for dead with a proving unit before touching any conductor. We can use the meter to measure resistance. Resistance is measured in ohms and as its name suggests, it is the measurement of the restriction to the flow of electricity. The easier the current flows through a conductor, then the lower the resistance. Long, low diameter cable will have a high resistance, whereas short, high diameter cable will have a low resistance. In instrumentation, the types of things we would be measuring the resistance of are point-to-point signal and power cables, relay and solenoid coil resistances, resistance between earth or bonding straps, testing of fuses. To test for resistance, we need to have our probes connected to the common and ohm symbol. Our probes are red and black. For resistant measurements, it does not matter what colour probes we connect to the earth port on the meter. However, it is good practice to connect the black probe to the common and red probe to the ohms connection. This is because when measuring voltage, the polarity is important. If you were to look at the readout, you will see the resistance reading is showing open circuit. To test the meter is functioning correctly and our leads fuses have not blown, a quick continuity test is useful. Connect the probe ends together. The meter display should read a small ohms value of around 2 or 3 ohms. This is the resistance of the test lead. It is useful to take this reading as a reference as the resistance will need to be subtracted from any part of a circuit you test. Now you can repeat the test with any part of a circuit you wish to measure. The continuity mode will beep whenever there is electrical continuity between the probes. This function is useful for fault finding or checking fuses. Probes are in the common and continuity ports as shown. In this mode, the meter can be used to detect if a diode is functioning correctly. A diode is a device that allows current to flow in a single direction and can be either forward or reverse biased. If connected to a diode in this mode, the meter will read a small voltage if the diode is allowing flow from the red probe to the black. It will show open circuit if the diode is not allowing current to flow. Diodes can be found in dual power supply setups and for some hardwired logic applications. If we press the function button while in this mode, it will allow us to test for capacitance of a capacitor from nano to microfarads, which is the unit of capacitance. To test the capacitance, simply measure across each leg of the capacitor. You won't frequently be taking capacitance readings as a technician, as this is normally reserved for old electronic board repair type applications where you may be looking to measure specific capacitor readings. The Fluke 117 can be used to measure currents of up to 10 amps. AC currents are normally measured to check the load of supply circuits. In order to do this, you would have to isolate the circuit, pick a point to break the circuit, and insert the meter in series with one of the legs. Notice the port used for current measurements are different from voltage measurements. The polarity doesn't matter in AC current applications. Be careful not to leave exposed conductors while the meter is in series. Use connector block wherever applicable to help avoid shock. Reconnect the circuit and take your current reading. If the current is above 10 amps, the internal fuse will likely blow to protect the device. As with the AC measurements, the frequency of the voltage can be checked in this mode via the use of the yellow button. You can also measure DC voltage. As with AC, you might need to test power draw of supply voltage. DC currents are often used as signals too, such as 4 to 20 milliamps for a pressure or temperature transmitter. You would measure the current exactly the same as the AC voltage by isolating the loop and going in series with the circuit. I want to finish up with a simple pressure transmitter loop we used in a previous video and then show how we would test for voltage and current with the multimeter. Here is our circuit. This is a 4 to 20 milliamp transmitter powered by 24 volts DC from a barrier that then passes the signal back to the PLC. If we were to measure voltage at the transmitter head, we would put our meter into volts DC mode and connect our red probe to the positive terminal and our black probe to the negative terminal. We would then be reading the potential difference across the transmitter. If we wanted to measure the milliamp current within the circuit, we would first put our meter into current DC mode. We would then isolate the circuit by powering down the barrier, then break into the loop. Because we are measuring current, it doesn't matter where in the circuit we take our measurement from, as current is always equal in a two-wire loop. It's normally easiest to do this at the transmitter or head. Disconnect the positive terminal, connect the positive probe to the supply coming from the barrier that we have just disconnected. Connect the common lead to the positive terminal of the transmitter. The meter now forms part of the circuit when we repower the loop and we will get the current readout of the loop. If you are interested in purchasing the Fluke 117, check a link in the description to Amazon for this meter. If you do decide to make a purchase, please do so and go through the link as I'll get a small commission for pointing you over and it won't cost you any more than if you had navigated there yourself. I hope you have enjoyed and found this video helpful. If you have, please go ahead and press the like button and subscribe with notifications for great content in the future. Thank you.